ओके सो टॉकिंग अबाउट ऊप्स, फाइन, इन ऊप्स ऑब्वियसली मैनी ऑफ यू मस्ट हैव डन दैट बिफोर. वी क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट्स, फाइन, एंड वी क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ क्लासेस, राइट. आई विल क्रिएट अ न्यू क्लास नेम्ड एज से एनिमल, फाइन, अ बेसिक क्लास एनिमल विच विल हैव टू प्रॉपर्टीज. ओके, टू प्रॉपर्टीज लाइक इंट एज ऑफ द एनिमल एंड स्ट्रिंग नेम ऑफ द एनिमल. सो एनी एनिमल विल हैव अ नेम एंड एन एज. ओके, एंड दिस क्लास हैज गॉट नो मेन फंक्शन, राइट. नाउ लेट मी क्रिएट वन मोर क्लास नोन एज टेस्ट एनिमल. फाइन, एंड आई विल क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एनिमल क्लास एनिमल से ए वन इक्वल्स टू न्यू एनिमल. नाउ व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय दिस लाइन? ओके, लेट मी जस्ट राइट दिस मच. न्यू एनिमल, दैट इज आई एम क्रिएटिंग द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ द एनिमल क्लास. व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय दिस? बाय राइटिंग दिस, व्हाट वी डू इज दैट, जस्ट अ मिनट, वी क्रिएट एन ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर क्लास. ओके, लेट मी सिंपली ओपन एम एस पेंट एंड एक्सप्लेन यू. व्हाट हैपन्स इन द मेमरी इज दैट द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एनिमल क्लास इज क्रिएटेड व्हेन वी राइट दिस. ओके, एंड ऑब्जेक्ट हैज गॉट टू प्रॉपर्टीज, नेम एज, राइट. एंड आउट हेयर आउट हेयर इट इज जस्ट एन ऑब्जेक्ट विच इज हैंगिंग इन द मेमरी. यू कैनॉट एक्सेस इट. ओके, यू कैन क्रिएट एज मेनी ऑब्जेक्ट्स एज यू वॉन्ट, राइट. आई कैन क्रिएट मे बी थ्री ऑब्जेक्ट्स. ऑल राइट, आई हैव क्रिएटेड थ्री ऑब्जेक्ट्स. एवरी ऑब्जेक्ट विल हैव नेम एंड एज. बाय राइटिंग दिस आई कैन क्रिएट मल्टीपल ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ द एनिमल क्लास. ओके, राइट. सो यू कैन क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट रेफरेंसेस लाइक दिस. एनिमल ए वन इक्वल्स टू न्यू एनिमल. ए वन बिकम्स द ऑब्जेक्ट रेफरेंस. ए वन विल पॉइंट towards the object. Okay, with A1 you can change the state of the object. Okay, right. And you can have an object reference for every object. Okay, say maybe I will have A1, A2, A3. So you can have animal A1, A2, A3. Okay, now object is different and object reference is different. Object reference points towards the object. Fine. With object reference you can change the state of the object. All right. And out here you can also write like this, that is animal a 4 equals to null. This means that this reference is not pointing anywhere. Okay, if it is null, that means it is just hanging in the memory. Maybe A4 is somewhere over here. It is not pointing to any object. This is A4. Alright. Now, with A1, A2, A3, you can change the state of the object. You can write over here A1 dot name is, say, cat. A1 dot age is, say, 5. So with the dot operator, you can access, right, with the dot operator, you can access the fields which are there inside the animal class. When you write A1 dot, you will get the field names. Okay, similarly, you can write A2 dot name is dog, A2 dot age is 10. Right, and similarly A3 dot name is a cow. So I have created 3 objects. Right, and I have created 3 objects over here named as cat, dog and cow, with ages 5, 10, 15. Okay, right. And with A1, A2, A3, you can point towards those objects. Right. And you can print. You can print, say, A1 dot name. This will print the values of A1, A2, A3 names. And when you run this, this will print like this. But guys, there is one thing. Sometimes I have seen people printing the object reference. If I print A1 and if I run it, it will not print me anything. It will print me some weird value. Okay. Right. And the difference lies out here. That is, suppose in the animal function, in the animal class, I also make a function known as public void print details, which will print the details of the animal. It's going to print the name followed by the age. Okay, so what will happen is that this print details function will be a part of every object. Okay, this becomes part of every object. Okay, and you can call it from every object reference. You can, instead of, you know, writing A1 dot name, A2 dot name and all, I will just put a demarking boundary and you can just write A1 dot print details. Similarly, A2 dot print details, A3. See, the function is same, but a difference, different object reference is calling the function. When A1 will call print details, it will print the details for A1. Okay, and similarly for A2 and A3. When I run this code, you see that? Okay. Right. Now, out here, if I write A1 or A2 equals to A3, now this creates a difference. What do you mean by A2 equals to A3? By writing A2 equals to A3, I am pointing A2 to the location where A3 is pointing. A2 will no longer point towards this object. Okay, A2 will remove the reference, A2 as a reference will be removed, and A2 and A3 both will point towards this object. Okay, and if I print the same thing now, a1.printDetails, a2.printDetails and a3.printDetails, and if I run the code, see A2 and A3 we are printing the details but for the same object A3, the object to which A3 was pointing towards, right? Right, anybody with any questions? Hello? This is the main function. This is the starting point for every program which you have to execute. Okay, if you have to execute this program, this is the main function. I think your microphone is... Harsha, sorry, I have muted you, Harsha. Your microphone was causing a noise. I am saying that main function is the starting function for every program. It's there in C as well. Okay, but what is static and all, I'll tell you. It is the function in which the controls comes in. Okay, in animal we never had the main function. If I right click on animal and try to run it as Java file, I will not get the option. But in a test animal, I have the main function. If I right click on it and run as Java application, you see that I get this option because main function is present in test animal. In test animal class, I'm accessing the animal class and I'm creating objects of the animal class. Okay. And what I'm trying to tell you is that object and object references, they are different. Right. Okay, now out here the difference is that the object, it will remain same in the memory, but object reference can be pointed from one object to the another object. Like I moved the object reference over here. Okay, now technically these variables, these are known as non static global variable. This is a non-static global variable. Age, it is also a non-static. What is static? It will come to you in some time, right? And print details, it is known as a non-static function. To access the non-static properties of a class, you have to create the object of the class. Only by creating object and object reference, you can access the non-static properties. Right. Out here, if you click on animal file, then the non-static properties of this particular file, they are inside the object. Whenever you create the object, those properties, they go inside it. Fine. Now suppose there is a property known as int eyes. Alright. Now I create the object of cat and I write over here the object of cat a1 dot number of eyes R2. Similarly, for A2, similarly for A3. Right. Okay. Now every object has got eyes. Okay, but the problem is I have to create the eyes variable inside every object with the value 2. I know the value is going to remain 2, but unnecessarily I have to create it inside every object. Fine. Okay. Now, what we do is that we make it static. When you make it static, what happens is that eyes will no longer be the part inside the object. It goes and resides at some memory location, which is common. You can say that in layman's term, you can say that this location is common for all the objects. Okay, right. So to access the static variables, all right, this is known as a static global variable. To access the static variables, you should not be accessing them with the object references. You see that there is a yellow warning sign over here. Okay, right. Okay, right. And out here, just a minute, I have to delete this. I cannot access the static properties. It's not a good practice to access the static properties with the help of object reference, because it's actually gone out here. Right. Okay. Because it's not inside the object, it's at some common location. Fine. And out here, what we do is that we access it with the help of the class. What we do is that we can write over here animal dot eyes are equal to 2. We can directly access the static properties with the name of the class. For non-static properties, you will have to create the objects of the class. You see, I am creating the objects of the animal class over here. I am creating the objects, I am initializing the objects. Right. Okay. And for the static properties, you can access it directly with the name of the class. Okay, right. So once I write animal.eyes are equal to 2, so this variable becomes 2 and all the animals will have obviously 2 eyes. Right. If I run this program, I'll get the same output. Fine. Similarly, you can have static functions as well. Okay, you don't have to declare the variables which are repeated inside the class as non-static. You can put them as static, some variables which are common for all the objects. You can create a function like a public static xyz. Okay, sorry, void. Okay, so inside it you can print anything. Say I'll just write testing. To access this xyz function, you can access it without creating the object of the class. I can just write animal.xyz. I'll get the option. You see that? You get the option. And when you run this code, you see that over here it will print testing. Okay, right. But yes, when we work with Selenium, most of the times we use the non-static stuff. Okay, we do use static stuff, but you know, not that much. Right. Now out here, just a moment. This is fine. This is good. Yeah. Okay. Now out here, you have to understand one thing. See, this is my static function. This is my non-static function. Okay. Now static stuff cannot access non-static stuff. All right, what do you mean by that? This is something which is quite famous in Java. If I call the print details function, suppose from XYZ function, I will get an error. See, XYZ function is somewhere over here in the memory, it is static. And I'm calling print details function. Which object's print details function has to be called? Whether it is this one, this one, this one. So obviously it is not something which can be decided. So this is not allowed. But yes, the opposite is true. You can call non-static from static functions. Okay, or in non-static, you can access the static variables as well. I can just print the value of eyes over here. Eyes is a static variable I can use. Okay, so non-static can access static. This is a rule. Understand this rule. Non-static can access static. But the opposite, that is in XYZ, I call the print details function and I print the age. Right. You cannot access the static cannot access the non-static things. You cannot do that. Okay, so the rule is static cannot access non-static. Do some exercises. Log in into your account if you have registered for the course. Okay, I'll tell you, this thing will be more clear, static and non-static. I have kept lots of exercises in the account. For people who have already enrolled, okay, you go inside your account and go to this module. Hold on. Just a minute, this browser is hanging. Okay, so hold on. When you go here, go to this Java Object Oriented, and in the first module you will see exercises. After you click on play, after logging in you will see exercises. Try to solve them. This concept will get more clear. Okay, now how do we use objects in Selenium? We use objects everywhere in Selenium. All right, if I go to the official website of Selenium, which is selenium.dev, and go to the downloads section, right, and you go to Java and go to API docs. So this is the official documentation of Selenium. It is actually having lots of classes. You see that these are all the classes in Selenium. I also don't remember all the classes. Nobody does. Okay, scroll down, you will be seeing something known as WebDriver written in italics. Okay, You click on this, you will find something known as interface web driver written. Okay, now what is interface? I'll talk about that in coming classes, maybe tomorrow. Okay, but yes, these are all the classes primary. This is the starting point of the documentation or the starting point of the architecture. And these are all the classes: Chrome driver, Edge driver, you know, event firing driver, Firefox driver. For every browser in Selenium, there is a class. Okay, and we create the objects of that particular, these particular classes to work with those particular browsers, right? For example, Chrome. Okay, if I just have to work with Chrome, let us talk about how objects will be used in Selenium. Okay, I don't want to just directly teach you Java then teach you Selenium. It will not make any sense. Okay, I'll create a new class known as drivers, Selenium drivers, or drivers Selenium, right? And in the main function, I'll create the object of Chrome driver class, but I will get an error. I will have to import the Selenium dependencies or the Selenium jars, the reference Selenium jars which we have imported in day 1 yesterday. Okay, I'll have to right click on day 2. For every project you have to import the jar files. Yesterday I had told you about the jar files, right? This is the alpha 6 jar file folder which we had created. These are the Selenium jars. You need to again put them in the project. So you right click on the project, go to the properties, go to Java build path, fine, and go to the libraries tab. Click on add external jars and add all these jars which are in the library, and also the ones which are outside the library folder, both of them. Now you will see reference library section and your project is Selenium enabled. Okay, you move the mouse over this error Chrome driver and import. You will get the option to import Chrome driver class. Right, now the thing is, you import this Chrome driver, and when you run this, you will see that, as I told you yesterday as well, a Chrome browser will launch, but I am getting an error. I'll tell you why that error is coming up. You will also get the error. Right, now the thing is, out here, if you go to the website, the official website, then you know, for every browser there is an exe, the driver exe, which you need to download to automate that browser. You cannot just automate it directly in Selenium. Okay, you will see the section over here, browser section. For every browser they have given a link. For example, for Chrome, all right, you open this link. The link is from Google. Actually, every browser manufacturer or every browser provider gives you an exe or a dependency with which that browser can be automated. You have to download that particular dependency. Okay, first of all, you have to check the version of browser you are using. For example, in my machine, I will go to help about Google Chrome. The version is 85.0.4183. Okay, and you have to download, see, this is my version, latest stable. My Chrome got automatically updated to this version. In case you have an older version, you can go to the download section and search your version over here. Okay, one or two minor differences in version will do, but it should not be that you are on 85 and you are downloading the exe for 83 or 84. Okay, so this is my version. I'll click on it and I'll get this page. I'll download the Chrome driver exe for Windows 32 bit. Even if you have a 64 bit machine, you can download this 32 bit and open it. This is the zip file. You extract it. Okay. Out here, you open this folder and you will get this Chrome driver exe. This Chrome driver exe will be required in order to automate Chrome. Fine. So you copy this. Like in my machine, I have kept the exe. It got outdated actually. Just a minute. I don't know where I have kept it. Okay. Anyway, so what I'll do is that I'll make a new folder somewhere and I'll call it as drivers and I'll keep the Chrome driver exe over here. Fine. You copy the path. Alright. And you have to write a line over here that is system.setProperty. Look, system is a class. SetProperty is a static function inside the class. You can directly call it with the class name, that's why. Okay, right. Okay, out here, you can give the key as webdriver dot chrome dot driver and the value as the path to the exe. I have kept the exe at this path, chrome driver dot exe. Okay, you have to set it in the system path, webdriver dot chrome dot driver. And you create the object of Chrome driver, and when you run this now, you will see that a blank Chrome will open up. The error happens when you don't have the right version of Chrome and the right exe. See, earlier when I was running it, the Chrome was automatically closing because the versions issues were there. Okay, moreover, you know, you don't need to write this line in every program. Okay, for every browser, you will have to download an exe and set the system property like this, whether it is Chrome, Edge, any browser. But you don't need to write this line again and again. You can avoid it. What you can do is you can set it in your environment variables. Okay, go to My Computer Properties and go to Advanced System Settings. You will get a window like this, having different tabs. Okay, go to the Advanced tab and click on Environment Variables. Alright, and in the System Variables, you scroll down, there will be a Path variable. Okay, and create a new path and give the path of the folder where you will have kept the exe files. Like I have kept this path. Okay, I had forgotten this. So on this path, I have kept all the exes. Okay, I'll replace the Chrome driver exe which has been updated. Okay, if the browser updates tomorrow or something, the exes they get up, you have to download the latest exes. It's not getting updated, right? Anyways, look, what you need to do is that you need to set the system path over here. In case you have got Windows 7 or Windows 8, okay, you will get a window like this. Okay, go to the end, put a semicolon on this variable and give the path over here. Okay, now you'll have to restart your PC, and once you restart your PC, even if you don't give this line, your browser will automatically open. Fine. Okay. राइट ऑल राइट नाउ यू क्रिएट द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ क्रोम ड्राइवर लाइक दिस. You create the object of Chrome driver with the reference, and with this reference you can access the non-static properties. Okay, there are so many functions, the non-static functions in Chrome, like a function known as get. It will go to a URL. I can write any website, http say bbc.com. Writing the protocol in Selenium is very important. If you don't write the protocol, it will give you an error. It's not like UFT or something. Right. When you run this code, you will see that right, it opens BBC. Fine. Now similarly you can work with other browsers as well. You can create objects of the browsers, right? You can, you know, hold on just a minute, where is the documentation? This was the downloads link. Hold on, this is the document. Now out here I told you, you go to a web driver. This is web driver, and you have got other driver classes as well. Now for example, edge driver is for edge. Event fairing web driver has got some different usages and all, complex usage gestures and all. I'll talk about that later on. Remote web driver is used in case of Selenium grid when you have to run the test cases parallelly. Okay, and Opera driver and Safari driver are for Opera and Safari, but they are not very stable. The stable drivers are basically for the major browsers, Chrome, Edge, Firefox and all, right? For example, you have to work with Firefox. Okay, you will have to create the object of Firefox driver. All right, import it. And you have to get the exe for Firefox driver as well. Alright, in the download section, if you scroll down again under the browsers, you will see Firefox. You go to the documentation and they will give you the Gecko driver versions and all. Okay, so you just click on Gecko driver releases link over here. And download 0.27, it will work for all of you. Okay, download it as per your operating system. Fine, and keep the file in the drivers folder. You will get this gecko-driver.exe like I have kept. Fine, and if I run this program, double slash in front of a line will comment that line. It will make that line ineffective. Okay, if I run this program, I will see that. Hold on, see that a blank Firefox browser has opened. Okay, right. Right. Now in case you don't have the exe in the path, okay, you can simply write system dot set property web driver dot gecko dot driver. Okay, and give the path of the exe folder. Like I have in my PC over here. In case you don't set it in the environment variables, you can write like this, but you know, it doesn't make any sense. You should always set it in the environment variables when you are practicing. Okay, so jacodriver.exe. Alright, this will also work in case you don't have it in the environment variables. Now similarly, you can write firefoxdriver.get, go to the URL http://yahoo.com, and when you run this, you see that it opens Yahoo. Anybody with any questions? Anyone with any questions? In the login, some of the assignments I'll give you in the login, some of the assignments I'll give you in the class. Yes. Now over here, I would advise you to solve those exercises right now after this class in those object oriented programming section. Alright, I've kept a lot of good exercises over there, which will give you a very good insight. Fine. Now similarly, you know, for other drivers, like for example, if you have to work with Edge, you have got Edge driver. Fine. Now the thing is, when you are working with Firefox, I forgot to tell you one thing. Firefox updates itself automatically at times, and JackoDriver.exe is updated by the Firefox guys quite late. Chrome guys are very fast. If Chrome gets updated by Google, the Chrome driver latest exe, it comes upon the page, but JackoDriver takes a little while. So it's always good that you turn off automatic updates in Firefox. In Chrome it is not possible to turn off automatic updates. In Firefox it is. Right. You go to tools, or you go to tools options and search for update. Okay, and check on this checkbox, check for updates, but let you choose them to install this. Don't let Firefox automatically update itself. Right. Now similarly, you have got Edge driver. Alright, you create the object of Edge driver class. But for Edge driver also, from Microsoft, you have an exe. Okay, you go to the download section, and for Edge, this is the documentation link. You go to the website. Now there are different releases, release 87, 86, right? You have to open the Edge of your website, of your PC, sorry, and open up Edge and check out the version of Edge which is there. Update your Edge. Always keep your Edge updated. Okay, it won't give you any issue in automation. Fine. And in Edge, you go to settings. Out here, about Microsoft Edge, the last setting link. My version is 85.0.564. Okay. So this is the one. All right, and I can choose my Windows as 64-bit Windows operating system. Click on this link and download the Edge driver exe. I already have kept it over here, MS Edge driver. Fine. And you create the object of Edge driver, and you just need to write this line in case you want to set the system property yourself. webdriver.edge.driver, and give the path of the exe. Okay, In case you have set it in the environment variables, you can just get this and write edge driver dot get to some UR, and this will work. This is going to launch Edge. With Edge also you have to be careful with the version. Right. So it gave me an error. Session not created. Maybe I have an old, yeah, you see that I have the Edge driver exe for 83 version. It will clearly tell you the error. You should always see the error. Session not created. Edge driver only supports Edge 83. I have the older version of exe. Fine. But once I update it, it's going to run. Fine. For example, I have downloaded the exe, and if I go to the downloads, I extract this and copy the exe, put it in this folder and give this path, that is, it is inside this folder. And when you run this now, if I work with the latest exe, you see that Edge opens up now. Fine. Okay, and it is going to the website as well. Actually, Edge is almost Chrome now, because there is a pact between Microsoft and Chrome. The engine of Edge is now Chromium based. It's Chromium engine. It's not by Microsoft anymore. Okay. So internally Edge is Chrome only these days. Alright. Now we have three drivers. Similarly, you have Internet Explorer driver, but you know, it's as a browser, it's obsolete. Hardly anybody uses it. Okay. But as a beginner, you can focus on these things. Now the question arises that, fine, I know how to create objects. Okay. Selenium is all about creating objects. Fine. Okay, Shantan, I saw your question right now. I'll answer that in some time. Selenium is all about creating objects. This out here, we are just creating objects of internal classes. Everything is inbuilt. And you should be knowing those commands. That's it. Okay, so everything is inbuilt. Right, and moreover, you don't have to write the code separately for all the browsers. You can write a single script which can work on all the browsers. We will discuss that tomorrow, not today. But if you have any questions, you can ask me right now. There is one of the questions that, where are we going to find the recordings? I will be emailing you the recordings. Like yesterday, I had emailed everybody the recordings. You will be getting an email. I hope you got yesterday's email, and the documents and all will be available in the account as well. Okay, once the trial classes are over, the recordings will come up in your login account as well. When you log in, you will be able to see the recordings.